This is the car market of Europe, one of the biggest markets in the world and home of the oldest car manufacturers in the world. As you can see, it's mostly dominated by European car makers like Volkswagen, which holds almost 25% of the market, followed by PSA Group, Renault and other European car manufacturers. Only 25% of the European market is shared with foreign car brands. And this is the car market of Japan, the world's third biggest automobile market. Almost 90% of the market belongs to native Japanese brands, and another 10% is European luxury car companies like Mercedes, BMW, Audi, and Porsche. And now let's look at the second biggest car market in the world, the United States of America. Historically, the dominance of the three big car companies, GM, Ford, and Chrysler, they had a combined market share of 90% in 1965. Granted muscle cars and absence of foreign competition, American car engineering was at peak. Moving fast forward, Ford and GM combined represented more than 50% of the US car sales in every year until 2001, and subsequently fell below 33% for the first time in 2012. By 2018, the combined market share of the American Big Three fell to an all-time low of 44.2%. And the other 56% is shared with European and Japanese car brands. Interestingly, European and Japanese car makers not only have a tight grip in their native markets, but they also dominate in China and the US, two of the biggest car markets in the world. If you look at the American car companies, not only they don't have any significant portion of the foreign market, but they can't even dominate in their domestic market, which got me thinking, why American car brands suck? In 2017, General Motors sold its European car branches Opel and Vauxhall to PSA Group for $2 billion, thus exiting Europe almost completely. In 2016, GM sold almost 1 million cars in Europe, and 99.8% of that was Opel and Vauxhall brands. And in 2018, it sold minuscule 3,463 Chevys and Cadillacs in Europe. In 17 years, GM Opel Vauxhall branches nearly lost $20 billion. And here was the problem of GM in Europe. Opel was originally a German car brand, so their products were, after their takeover, first perceived as German cars. GM would regularly rotate in and out hotshot managers at the top of Opel Europe. Their job performance was rated based on their ability to reduce costs. One manager would reduce costs by, say, 3%, then be replaced by the next manager, who was incentivized to do the same. Obviously, after enough rotations, Opel was purely focused on making cheap cars rather than good cars. Nothing GM released in Europe could qualitatively compete with other European car makers. And then Opel brand associated was faulty, unreliable, and cheap. And that was the end of Opel profitability in Europe. 30 years ago, Opel and Audi produced cars of the same level in Germany, namely the entry premium level cars. Fast forward 30 years, Audi is a major premium brand in the world, while Opel is competing with Chevys thanks to GM management. Even Donald Trump weighs in this mess. He criticized Germany and Japan of inventing one-way street, saying he sees a lot of Mercedes-Benzes and other Japanese cars in the US, but he doesn't see any Chevrolets in Germany or in Japan. Vice Chancellor of Germany replied back, "Build better cars." That's a classic German mic drop. Ironically, Opel Vauxhall under PSA Group made a profit of $979 million in 2018 compared with $257 million loss in 2016 under GM management. It's really funny, GM couldn't turn a profit for 20 years, bleeding money, and then in its first year, the new owner makes nearly $1 billion in profit. That's the biggest LOL ever. GM left India, Japan, and now Europe. The one of the biggest mistakes of GM was its inability to adapt to a foreign market. You can't just ship out huge pickup trucks and gas-guzzling SUVs to the thousand-year-old narrow roads of European cities. You either adapt to the specific market or get decapitated by competitors. So the GM chose the latter. In 2018, Ford announced it will phase out most cars it sells in North America. They will only sell Mustang and Focus Active. By 2020, 90% of Ford's North American market will only be crossovers, trucks, and SUVs. It's mostly based on consumer demand and product profitability, and rightly so. As of 2018, trucks and SUVs made 68% of the US car market. Additionally, car companies make a hefty amount of profit by selling trucks and SUVs, as they are inherently expensive vehicles than a sedan. Even luxury car brands like Ferrari, Lamborghini, Jaguar, and Maserati are getting into SUV business. So Ford in return will stop investing in the next generation sedans. GM also dropping its 6 sedan models, closing down its 3 biggest sedan producing plants, and focuses on making trucks, SUVs, and electric cars. Yet 32% of the sedan market, Toyota has no problem selling their Corolla and Camry, and Honda has no problem selling their Accords and Civics. Well, generally, Americans love trucks and SUVs, but one of the other reasons why people are buying these vehicles is because gas prices are pretty low now. Today's SUVs don't guzzle gas like their predecessors, but they still get worse mileage than a sedan. All you need is one major news event from the Middle East, and gas prices will skyrocket again just like it was in 1973 oil crisis. And then all these soccer moms buying SUVs will start complaining that they can afford Christmas present for their little Johnny. Americans owe around $1.2 trillion in auto loan debt, not to mention the large pool of subprime auto loans. And statistically, 7 out of 10 Americans live paycheck to paycheck and cannot truly afford these expensive vehicles. And here is an interesting analysis. In 2005, before an economic recession, 12 million trucks and SUVs and 8 million sedans sold in the US. In 2010, during the recession, sedans gained popularity because of economic use of fuel and overall much cheaper than SUVs. 8.2 million sedans and 6 million SUVs and trucks sold in the US in that year. And the last year, 2018, again, more than 12 million SUVs and trucks, and unusually low, almost 5 million sedans sold in the US. Well, the next recession will probably make 2008 financial crisis look like a picnic. So this is the typical US corporate philosophy, always aiming for the short-term profit. Gas prices will not be this low forever, and when they rise, GM and Ford will be asking the US government for another hefty bailout, just like they did back in 2008. One of the other reasons why US automakers invest millions of dollars in marketing to sell SUVs and trucks for Americans in the US is because they are protected by the bill called Chicken Tax. Chicken Tax is a 25% tariff imposed on foreign-made large trucks and vans imported into the United States. Basically, it was intended to protect the US automakers from foreign competition in retaliation to Europe, when Europe imposed tariffs on chickens imported from the US. The only reason why American car brands are still relatively profitable selling SUVs and trucks in the US is because the US government have protected them from foreign SUVs and trucks coming into the country. Even though Ford is more popular than GM in Europe, it has financial losses on the continent. By the end of 2019, Ford expected to post $3.6 billion losses in the European market. Ford left Japanese, Indonesian, and Russian markets a few years ago, where Japanese and European car brands thrive. Frankly, American car companies find it easier to roll over rather than actually compete. One of the biggest reasons why majority of people favor foreign cars than American brands is the reliability and quality. 2018 was a tumultuous year for the American brands, especially Ford. Its sales dropped 15% from 2017, and it has recalled 1.6 million Ford F-150 pickup trucks that have issues with front seat belts. In fact, top 3 biggest car recalls in 2018 was all American car brands. 1.3 million Ford Fusion and Lincoln MKZ that have issues with steering wheel bolt, allowing the steering wheel to potentially detach, about which is more than enough to cause the alarm. And another 1.3 million Ford Focuses with fuel tank issues have been recalled. Generally, American cars have lower reliability and quality, except Ford Fiesta, that is produced in Germany for the European market. Other than that, most of the models are not reliable enough. But on the other end of the spectrum, Japanese quality dominates all around the world. The main reason that Japanese cars consistently rate higher in terms of quality than US cars are, Japanese cars are built by two world-class manufacturers, Honda and Toyota. It has little to do with Japan versus the USA and everything to do with different styles of corporate management. Honda and Toyota have been very profitable, and profit makes it much easier for a company to emphasize quality. And Japanese companies generally follow the Kaizen principle, which generally means continuous improvement. It goes hand in hand with the statement that Toyota and Honda emphasize quality, because the Kaizen system in and of itself emphasizes proactively looking for defects and problems before they happen. And companies using the system often incentivize their employees to do so by offering cash rewards per defect found and corrected. Toyota in particular is known for its practice of Kaizen, and it's often called Toyota Way. This principle puts them in a position that put quality and efficiency in the highest priority possible. But in the hyper-capitalistic United States, manufacturers emphasize profits above all else, always monitoring quarter earnings. And that puts them at a fundamental disadvantage. At Honda and Toyota, management is comfortable with incremental improvements in sales. They don't demand big changes during every redesign. Management is very stable. The same people are in charge for years. This stable incremental approach means that engineering can focus on steadily improving every individual system in a vehicle, rather than reinventing something every 5-7 years. Now, GM loyalists might argue that Toyota and Honda can only afford this approach because they are so profitable, but Toyota and Honda are doing this approach for decades, which is why they are profitable. US car makers, at least historically, management changes frequently, and with these management changes, we see dramatic changes in corporate direction, product planning, resource allocation, and other structural changes. Management often demands revolutionary new products. While this demand for innovation is good for the industry as a whole, it's a very, very risky approach to the car business. After all, if the next big thing is a flop, your company just wasted a couple of billion dollars. Because management is more fluid and expectations generally favor more dramatic improvement, engineers are rarely given the chance to focus on incrementally improving products purely for the sake of improving quality, because the shareholder value usually determines the success of a US manufacturer's management team, the pressure to increase profits this quarter is a never-ending loop. Engineers are far more likely to be asked to find a way to reduce costs than improving quality. Because there is so much emphasis in quarterly reporting, US automakers often struggle to embrace long-term planning. Furthermore, management of both Honda and Toyota develop leaders out of their engineering ranks. For example, virtually every CEOs of Honda have been engineers. Meanwhile, Ford's current CEO came out of furniture industry to the top position in Ford company. Generally, a lot of American companies tend to be led by sales guys, which often puts them in the philosophy of telling consumers what they want, instead of building what a consumer wants. And that is backfiring in Europe and Asia, as we see those companies leaving countries by countries every year. At the end of the day, you might have a GM, Ford, and Chrysler product that hasn't shown any problems even at 500,000 miles. It also somehow depends on what kind of a driver you are and how often you take care of your car and so on. So don't take it too hard. I have purposefully skipped Tesla because Tesla deserves its own kind of video. I'll put a poll in the cards. If you want to see a thorough video about Tesla or not, please vote here. By that, I can start to work on it or not. Thank you for watching. What do you think about the American car brands, and have you owned one? If yes, please share your thoughts down in the comment section below. There are a few videos in the production right now. I'm kinda enjoying doing videos in this format. The next one probably will be a bit different. If you like the videos, please hit the like button and subscribe if you haven't.